So I'm Ed. I'm a small neurologist from London. I'm also an HD researcher. I have a small, talented team of HD researchers also in London. I work at UCL, just falling off the bottom of the screen. I'm a consultant neurologist, which is cool if that's what you wanted to be for a while, and then you become one, that is good. I also founded HD Buzz, which, hands up if you heard of HD Buzz, you surely must all have, okay. Do you read it at all? Good, bad?
Sometimes,
okay. I'm pleased you've heard of it, and it's there for people like you, and that's why we set it up. So, I've been an HD researcher for 11 years, which is a long time. And I was young when I first started, and now I am not young, which is a shame, but you know, that's what happens. I've got some slides and I can talk through them, and it's a very interesting time in HD research, which I'll come back to, but there's one big thing that's happening now, which has never happened before, that could potentially change everything for people from HD families. And it might not do, but if it does, that would be really cool. And I'll tell you about some cool stuff that's happening. But I'm guessing, so you've been here for like a week, right? And today's the last day. And I gather that some of you had a late night. And it's possible that some of you have just turned 18 today. So so I understand that if I just stand here and talk for 2 hours, then everyone will die. So ask me some questions. What do you wonder about? What do you worry about? What are you excited about? What does HD research mean to you? Have any of you been in an HD research study? Have any of you heard of any big HD studies?
Yeah.
Kat, you don't count. Sorry, you're too old now. You're like me, you're too old. Kat, what are the names of some HD... Yeah, no worries. Join the club. What are the names of some HD studies? Someone's saying enroll. That's good. I like that.
I don't remember the name. There's one that is in Germany and in England. And they're taking blood processes. They're watching the head. And there's something there. And we've got over 21 weeks now. I don't remember what it's called.
Oh, so they're taking blood from people. Yeah. And they're doing brain scans as well, are they? Ah, okay. Lumbar puncture. Heard of that? So how does it sound to people? Sound like fun? Would you, hands up if you would volunteer for a lumbar puncture to donate spinal fluid for HD research. Oh, that's pretty good. All right. I'll be collecting your names and addresses at the end. You basically just gave informed consent to take part in that study, and you cannot revoke that. That's happening now. Have you heard of Predict HD? Track HD, Registry, that's a slightly older one. I think the one you need to have heard of is Enroll HD. And there's a kind of, so one of the things I really like about HDYO is that it's a completely new way of looking at HD. And so the previous generation would kind of just not talk about it, try and pretend it didn't exist, or, you know, not talk to their kids about HD properly, and the kids didn't have anyone else to talk to. And as a result, you know, I think there was a lot of fear of the unknown that didn't need to be there. And this kind of thing, the existence of HDYO, really represents a completely new way of dealing with HD, which I'm absolutely certain will completely change the future for you guys and everyone else from HD families who comes next. No doubt at all. There's a new way of thinking about research that I think needs to go along with that. And we get a lot of messages through the HD Buzz like messaging interface. And generally speaking, people read our articles and they're like, this is brilliant, this is great news, you know, thanks for telling us about this, we're really excited. Occasionally we get someone who's a bit skeptical. And we got this one message that said, this sounds great, let me know when they're testing the cure. And that kind of talks about an attitude to research that's very old-fashioned and isn't really going to work. So it's kind of us and them. Do you see what I mean? When they are testing the cure. It's as if there's HD families here and there's researchers here, and we're just sort of doing this thing that has nothing to do with the families, and we invent a cure, or we find a cure down the back of the sofa or something, and then we go, oh, hey guys, we found a cure. Do you want it? That's not really how it happens at all, and it's never been like that, actually. We basically work for you guys, and there are actually a lot of people in the research community worldwide who are from HD families, and our job is to work with you and to help you to find the cure for Huntington's disease or to find treatments for Huntington's disease. You're the people who need it, and we're the people who can help you find it or invent it, really. We're not going to find it, we're going to invent it together. And you can't do it without us, we can't do it without you. And it's not us and you at all. We are one big HD community. I like your poo cushion, by the way. Your poo emoji cushion just caught my eye. Where was I? Yeah, so I think that in the same way that you guys are completely on the cutting edge of how the world deals with HD, and you're rewriting history by being here and by knowing each other and by being part of HDYO, I'd like you also to be part of that rewriting of how research happens and how basically from the beginning all the way through, we need family members to be part of the research. And I'll give you some ideas about how you can do that. Right, so has anyone got any questions for me about Huntington's disease, about research? Question. How's it going with the spinal fluid thing? It's going well, but I don't want to, I'll tell you about that in a bit. That's a good question, though. What's the spinal fluid thing? Which one do you mean?
The ones that have been doing recently. You were in it, doing
it. Yeah. Is that you watching me on YouTube? She's stalking me online. Security! Okay, it's going very well, and I will talk more about that. Remember that. What's your name?
Annie.
Annie was the first person to mention the thing that's the cool thing I'm going to talk about in a bit. So props to Annie when that happens. Do people still say props? Is that a thing people say? Yeah, okay. It's very difficult. All my references are massively dated. When I started giving talks, I'd talk to roomfuls of scientists, and I'd talk about, I don't know, oh, this is going to, mysterious cities of gold or something. Nothing. They would be like, oh, we don't understand that. That reference is too young for us. And then, overnight, suddenly all my references are, 10 years out of date. I can't win. Harry Potter. That's a thing, right? Okay, fine. Okay, well, my time's up. So what is the cause of Huntington's disease? Anyone? Does anyone know? Does anyone in the world know? Do I know? Yes. I bet there are some people in this room who know. You're already tired, aren't you?
Yeah.
Hands up if you think Huntington's disease is caused by a virus. Hands up if you think it's an infection contracted from dogs. Hands up if you think that it's due to eating too much egg. Matt, he's always been a pioneering thinker. Hands up if you think that it's caused by a gene. Hey, I agree. Okay, what's the name of the gene that causes HD? Nah, chorea is one of the symptoms of HD. Someone said
Huntington.
Kind of. So the gene is actually called, the first name the gene had was IT15. Do you know how the gene was discovered? Do you know when it was discovered? 93. Hands up if you were born after 1993. Why am I asking this? It's just going to be really depressing. Okay. So, yeah, 1993. And it was discovered by about 100 major scientists and probably many, 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 many more scientists behind the scenes It was one of the first genes to be discovered for any brain disease. And we didn't really know how to find genes back in those days. So basically, 10 years before that, they'd narrowed it down to a little kind of neighborhood of DNA, about like a postcode. And then it took them 10 years to get from that postcode or that zip code to the one address where the gene lives. So the original name of the gene was IT15, which stands for interesting transcript 15. So a transcript is just one gene that you want to look at. And there were about 2,000 of them that they'd previously thought were of interest. They thought they'd be interesting to look at. And actually it was the 15th one they got to, but it took them 10 years. So it's kind of a good job it was the 15th rather than the 1900th. So the first name was IT15. And then they called it, and then when they figured out the gene was responsible for Huntington's disease, they called it Huntington. But it also, so we sometimes abbreviate it as HTT, which is short for Huntington, or HD. What does a gene do? What's a gene?
It encodes protein.
It encodes, who said that? That was a good answer. That was a very scientific answer, though. If I said that in an HD Buzz article, people would write to me and say, we don't know what this means. What are you saying? So when you encode something, what does that mean?
It provides the rest of it.
Good, better. Yeah, I agree. Instructions to make a protein, absolutely. And one, broadly speaking, one gene is one protein. And how many genes does it take to make a human being?
20,000 to 30,000.
Exactly. We don't know is the answer, because some of them are, there are lots of them and we don't know whether they actually produce proteins. So it's about 20,000 to 25,000. And how many genes does it take to make a dandelion flower? I think it's a lot more. I think dandelions have like three times, a lot of flowers have a lot more DNA. It's just like kind of noise DNA. I don't think they have more genes actually, but they have more DNA. That's not important. Don't remember that. There's a lot of stuff that, if you need to remember something, I'll say it's important. That was not one of those things. So a gene is a recipe for a protein. Maybe I have a slide about that. Yeah, here we are. That's DNA. It doesn't flash, and it's actually a lot smaller than that in real life. So DNA, where does DNA live? It's not a joke, it's a real question. Where does DNA live? Birmingham. Where does it live?
Chromosomes.
Yeah, what's a chromosome? These are the science people here, these are the geeks, aren't they? What's the name of the geeks?
Tim and Jonty.
Tim and Jonty, okay. So, someone else, what's a chromosome? Doesn't matter. It's good to be clever.
I wouldn't say that.
Okay. No, it is. Well, I enjoy it. What's a chromosome? A chromosome is just like a bundle of DNA, one big long DNA strand, all wrapped up like a sausage. And where does the DNA live? Where do the chromosomes live? You're right. What have you come there for?
Because I have to be your assistant.
What for?
I don't know, Matt says I have to
guilt you. I do. Do I look like I need help? Am I struggling, Matt?
It's very, very good at changing slides.
Yeah. Oh, no, it's okay, because you know what? I'm like skipping back and forth, so it's all good. We're all good. Thanks, though. It's less distracting with you there, anyway. You were sitting at the back. My loins were a quiver. I was in danger of fainting. Where does DNA live? You know what a cell is, right? Our bodies are made of cells. How many cells in the human body?
Lots.
Correct, but you only get half a mark for lots. Like, as if it was going to be hardly any. Like, three. 10 to the power of 13. So a one with 13 zeros after it. Maybe it's 11. It's a lot anyway. The first answer was better. So the number of stars, some of you were out stargazing last night watching the meteors. Did you see the Milky Way, the bright strip of stars across? So that's the galaxy that we live in. That's our galaxy, our home galaxy. It's part of a galactic supercluster called Laniakea, which is a Hawaiian word meaning the heavens, that was only described about four or five years ago. Not important. Beautiful though, that's our home address. I don't know how you're going to get 30 minutes out of this for the Scottish HDA people.
I'm really interested in how this is going to be edited together.
You can use my HDSA one. That's a lot more coherent, a lot more pre-planned. Anyway, so the Milky Way is huge. It contains I think something like 1,000 billion stars, or 10 to the 11. Yeah, no, 10 to the 11 is the number of stars in the Milky Way galaxy. That's a lot. And if you multiply that by 100, that's how many cells there are in the human body. Okay, that was important. A lot of cells. And which bit of the... So a cell is just, you know, like a little Lego building block, and we're made of lots of them. And inside the cell is a thing called the nucleus. You've heard of that? What's the... Is anyone here from Germany? What's the German word for nucleus?
Not me, I was just nodding.
That's the word for nucleus.
Nucleus.
Nucleus, there you go. The German word for nucleus is nucleus. Oh, Zellkern. Oh, as in kernel, like the kernel of a nut. That's cool. Okay. Nice. So the DNA is in the nucleus, and the DNA is a recipe for a protein. And in the past 12 months, we discovered what Huntington protein looks like. That's quite cool. It's a huge protein, and when a protein's big, it's really difficult to figure out what it looks like, which is weird, because you think if it was small, it would be difficult. But actually, in order to make a picture of a protein in three dimensions, you have to form it into crystals. And if the protein is big, it's very difficult to make it do that. So instead, you have to try and look at it directly, which is really hard, because it's actually, although it's a big protein, it's too small to see with microscopes. But we managed it, so an American team, and it looks a bit like a potato. So that was well worth the effort. So there's this DNA, this gene, the Huntington gene, and it's a recipe for the Huntington protein. And in people with HD, or people who are going to get HD, we call it mutant Huntington protein. And a lot of people don't like the M word. Although if you're a fan of the X-Men, that's still a thing, right? You know, mutation's not necessarily a bad thing. It just means something's different or sometimes special. So it's a special protein. It comes from a Latin word, mutare, which means to change. So it's a protein that's changed or different from the protein that most people have. Does anyone know what we call the opposite of mutant? Like the more common kind, the more common variety of protein?
Boring.
Yeah, it is boring. That's not the scientific name for it. Wild type, yeah. It's named after me. It's not really. It is boring, though, which is a shame. So in 1993, for the first time ever, it became a fact that Huntington's disease is caused by mutant Huntington protein, which is encoded by the mutant Huntington gene. And that's really important. Why is that important? Well, so Huntington's is not very common. Like, it's a pretty common brain disease. But if you think about other brain diseases like Parkinson's or Alzheimer's disease, you've heard of those, right? Those are very common. Like Alzheimer's disease, something like one person in 10 will get Alzheimer's disease during their lifetime. Parkinson's, something like 1 in 100. Very common diseases. Huntington's is something like 1 in 8,000, so it's much less common. What's the cause of Alzheimer's disease? Oh, goodness me. How old are you?
22.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's okay then. You look younger than 22, which is, if you were younger, it would not be okay to know that. That would be weird. But it's good that you know it. Except it may not be true. So she said beta amyloid plaques. What's beta amyloid?
It's a protein.
It's a protein. So in other words, it's a bad protein that's causing problems in our brains. Except that if you give a treatment that removes those plaques, Alzheimer's does not get better. And there's another protein called tau, which also builds up in Alzheimer's disease. And we don't know whether treating that will treat Alzheimer's disease. The answer is we don't know the cause of Alzheimer's disease. Some people think it's amyloid, some people think it's tau, some people think it's other things. And Alzheimer's is probably 10 different diseases. And there are some people, about 1% of people with Alzheimer's, who have a known mutation that causes their Alzheimer's disease. But the vast majority of people who get Alzheimer's, we've no idea what's caused it. And you can't really fix a problem unless you know what's caused it. Or let's say it's extremely difficult to fix a problem unless you know what's caused it. So Alzheimer's, all of these diseases are difficult, right? I'm not saying Huntington's is easy. What I'm saying is, unlike Alzheimer's, unlike Parkinson's, unlike motor neuron disease, we know the cause of every single case of Huntington's disease. This gene, this protein, that's the cause of HD in everyone. And while that does not solve the problem, that gives us a huge advantage when it comes to coming up with treatments. Because we know that if a treatment stops the bad effects of this protein in our brain cells, or can prevent the protein being made in the first place by switching off this gene, then it will definitely work. And that's not true of any gene in Alzheimer's or in any of the other brain diseases. Alzheimer's would love to have our gene. We call it a solid target. We know with certainty that that's the cause of HD in everyone. So it's a little bit more complicated than this. We've got the gene and we've got the protein, but it's a little bit more complicated than that. So I'm going to skip to the sci-fi landscape. There's a step in the middle, which I call a message. So we've got the gene, we've got the protein. There's a message in the middle. So this is what we call the basic dogma of biology. What's a dogma? Anyone?
Foundational belief.
Who's talking? Someone says something.
Foundational sort of belief.
A foundational belief. Yeah, that's true. It's a truth that is held to be so reliable that you can use it to build a complete system of thought. Good. Like a constitution. So a dogma is something so well demonstrated that you can sort of rely on it to be true. So the central dogma of biology is that genes are recipes for proteins, but they act through this intermediate molecule. What are genes made of? DNA. What does DNA stand for? Good. What are proteins made from? Who said amino acids?
Yeah.
What's your name?
Victoria.
Victoria, good. That's correct. Yes, that is correct that your name is Victoria. proteins are, you don't get any marks for that though. Proteins are made from amino acids. What's an amino acid? Oh, don't list them all, there's 21 of them. Those are some examples. So they're the building blocks that make up proteins. That's all you need to know, really. So what's this? You have to stop answering now. You're answering too quickly. Anyone who didn't hear that, what's this made from? RNA, good. What you'll see is that it's very similar to one strand of DNA. It's called RNA. Have you heard of RNA? Hands up if you've heard of RNA. This is messenger RNA, or mRNA. And what does RNA stand for? Yeah, good. It's just, so deoxy means doesn't have an oxygen. RNA means it does have an oxygen. So really this should be called ribonucleic acid because it doesn't have an oxygen. This should be called oxyribo. Anyway, but don't worry about that. Not important. Shut up. Okay, so you've got this message molecule. And that might be important because this stuff is locked away in the nucleus. Like if you had this really old valuable recipe book that was really beautiful but contained recipes that you wanted to make, but you don't want to get the book messy and get it torn up and get food all over it. So you keep the book in a different room and you take a photocopy of the recipe that you want. In fact, you want to make loads of this particular recipe, so you take 100 photocopies and then you take those into the kitchen and you give them out to the chefs. The photocopy is this, the message molecule. This is the recipe book. Keep that safe, make photocopies, make lots of photocopies, take them to the kitchen, and the chef will make the recipe. The recipe is the end product, the food is the protein. Does that make sense? I think I explained it very well. So because of that, because of what we know, and we'll come back to the message molecule, because of what we know about Huntington's disease, I call it the most curable, incurable brain disorder. We've got the certainty, the gene causes the disease. Gene, protein, Huntington's disease. We know that if we can get rid of the effects of that gene, we can get rid of the effects of Huntington's disease. There's more going on as well. There's more research that's been done that gives me great confidence that this is a solvable problem. So we use mice in our research because it's cheaper than using people and making people sick and, you know, chopping their heads off with scissors. We can't do that. So instead we use mice, and we are very grateful to all the mice and the other animals that have helped, because without them we would never make any progress, or it would take 10 times longer. So there's one experiment that was done in about 2000, maybe it was 2003, that was essentially a really important experiment in the history of Huntington's disease, and it was done by a Japanese-American researcher called Ai Yamamoto. So what happens is, ever since we had the gene, we've known how to make mice that get Huntington's disease. You can take the human gene that causes HD and you can put it in a mouse, and then the mouse gets sick. And it's not so good at walking on a treadmill, or if you put it on a piece of string, it takes longer to walk across it. The Ai Yamamoto experiment was cleverer than that, though. Oh, yeah, the mouse gets sick. The experiment that Ai Yamamoto did was much cleverer than that, though. What she did, instead of just putting in a normal gene that causes HD, she attached she made a special genetic switch, so that basically the gene that was put into the mouse had an on-off switch. Basically, you would just change one thing in the mouse's diet, and the extra gene that had been put in would be switched off. Now, that we can't do that in people. There's no off switch, magic off switch in people. This is just in this mouse. But she wanted to see what happened if you switched off the gene after the mice got sick. So she bred these mice with the special genetic switch. The mice got sick, as you would expect. The protein was building up in their brains, and the mice got sick. Then they changed the food, flipped the switch so it's off, and what do you think happened? Yeah, they did get better. So what they were hoping was, they would stay where they were. So they'd stay in this kind of sick position. Or maybe they would continue to get worse, but more slowly or something. But actually, they got much better. The symptoms got better. And when they looked at the brains under the microscope, a lot of the proteins and a lot of the gunk that had built up in the brains had been removed. Which tells us, I think, that, number one, this is a problem that the disease on its own moves in one direction, right? But it is possible to intervene to change the direction of the disease. And if you can take away some of the bad stuff that's happening in our brain cells, the brain cells actually have a really good capacity to get better. Now, what we can't do at the moment is replace any brain cells that have died. But that's something that's being worked on. And in 20 years, who knows? But this is really good news. You switch the gene off, the mice improve. That's important. The other thing is, I don't have slides about this, but there's this idea of, that's good news if you have symptoms of HD, but what happens if you switch off the gene before you get sick? Could we prevent Huntington's disease? And I think there's really every reason to believe that we can, because the average age of onset, the average age that people are when they get symptoms is somewhere in their 40s or 50s. Mid-40s is average. There's a lot of variation. But what that tells us is that people can live for many, many years in lots of cases with this gene switched on in their brains, but the brain cells can cope with it. And I think it's a bit like a backpacker, you know, climbing a mountain with a heavy rucksack. It would be easier to get to the top if you didn't have anything to carry. But I reckon if you can just make the rucksack a couple of kilograms lighter, you get much further up the mountain. And I think if we can treat people with the HD mutation early on in their lives, at the age of 18 or 20 or even younger than that, we don't need to make a big difference immediately for it to make a big difference in the future. So in other words, if we can do one little thing that's helpful, and keep it going for 20 years, that could make a massive difference. That could mean an extra 10, 20, 30 years of completely healthy brain function. And that's the absolute theory, that dogma, if you will, that we're working on in Huntington's disease. We all believe that if we treat people with symptoms of HD with something that really works, they'll get at least a little bit better. If we treat people before the onset of symptoms, we should be able to delay the onset of symptoms. So we should be able to keep people healthy for longer. And if we can do that successfully, we can basically give people a normal life expectancy. And you can die of old age, or being run over by a bus, or kidnapped by eagles, or whatever. Whatever you want, just not HD. So that would be nice. So I guess the question then is, how do we do it? How do we test drugs? Clinical trials. Have any of you got relatives who've been in a clinical trial? Which trial? Don't know. Okay. Did you go along to any of the visits or anything? When was it? Eight years ago. In which country? Okay, that was probably, that could have been the creatine or fish oil maybe, or possibly, okay, EPA. So that's interesting. Anyone else? Okay. So there aren't that many people who've been in drug trials, because to be honest, we haven't had many drug trials in Huntington's disease. When scientists are developing drugs for Huntington's disease, they think about what they call targets, right? So you want a target. A target is something that you try and design a drug to alter or change. So, for instance, I can't think of any. So when you're treating an infection, the target is the bacterium. The bacteria that's caused, say someone's got pneumonia, the antibiotic targets the cell wall of the bacterium and stops the bacterium from making new bacteria. In Huntington's disease, things are very complicated, because as soon as you made that protein, lots and lots and lots of individual things start to go wrong in your brain cells. And each of those is a possible target for HD drugs. So basically anything that goes wrong in HD is a potential target. And some of them are easy targets and some of them are very difficult targets. The protein itself turns out to be a very difficult target to hit. But there are lots of other things that people are trying. And basically they're about, right now in the lab, before they go to clinical trial, there are probably about 50 different things being worked on as potential ways of intervening to change the course of Huntington's disease, individual targets. From 1993 till about 2000, we just tried to understand the gene and the protein and figure out what was going on, and we made mouse models. And then from 2000 till about 2012, what we did was we said, right, we know what causes HD now, but all this information that we're getting isn't really helping us, because we just the more we study it, the more complicated it gets. And when we don't actually have drugs that will target these things. But what we do have is drugs that are kind of generally good for brains. So things like creatine, coenzyme Q, have you heard of these things? Have you heard of creatine? Any bodybuilders? So creatine is a protein supplement that bodybuilders or gym bunnies take to kind of help them build muscle. Coenzyme Q is a bit similar. It's a kind of it's something that helps the cells to use energy. And there are drugs that are used for things like epilepsy, which we know are sort of generally good at calming down our brain cells. So for about 10 years, we ran a load of huge clinical trials of things like that, sort of nutritional supplements that you can get over the counter, or drugs that were generally good for brains. And unfortunately, none of them worked. And everyone got a bit depressed, because it was like, oh, we've done all these trials, we've spent ages doing all these trials, we thought they might work, and they didn't work, and now we've got nothing. But actually, that's not how science works. Science works, it's what I call cumulative. Science is essentially a process of understanding a little bit more every day. So even when a drug trial fails, like has a negative outcome, that may mean that we don't have a new treatment for HD, But it doesn't mean we don't know anything, and it doesn't mean we haven't learned anything. And from those failed trials, we learn how to run trials properly, so how to actually design the trials and get people through them. And also, they help us to understand why the drug didn't work and what we need to do differently to come up with better drug targets. So right now, in the world, how many drug trials do you think are happening in Huntington's disease? Someone say a number.
Seven.
Seven? Higher or lower? Higher than seven. Any advances?
20.
It's lower than 20.
17.
Lower than 17?
15.
It's 14. You were close. 14 trials. That's an incredible number. The most trials we've ever had before was like two or three. Where I work in London at UCL, we're running three drug trials now. And in the past 10 years, we ran three trials. So we're running right now as many as we ran in the entire previous decade. It's not just about numbers, though. The drugs that we're testing now have been specifically designed with HD in mind. So they weren't just stuff that we had lying around that was generally good for brains that we said, well, we've got nothing else to test, let's test these. This is the stuff we've been waiting for. 23 years of studying the HD gene has brought us to this point where we're now testing the stuff that is based on what we've figured out about HD. A lot of people ask me, how long will it take? How long will it take? Why is it taking so long? And it turns out the answer is because this is how long it takes. And how we know that's how long it takes is because no one's ever done this before. There hasn't really been a major brain disease where we've gone from not knowing what causes it to knowing what causes it to developing drugs to treat the known things that go wrong to testing those drugs. And it takes 23 years. In the future, it'll be quicker because we will help other diseases to figure out treatments for their disease. But it turns out 23 years is about how long it will take us to get from the gene to the first clinical trials of the things that are targeting HD. So this is a phenomenally exciting time. It's been a long journey to get us to this point, and we all wish that it had happened quicker. And we're not there yet, right? So we don't have anything that we know works for HD yet. But I think we're very close. So let me tell you about some of the trials that are happening. Anyone know what this is? Someone said it at the back, I think. It's an amaryllis flower. What's the significance of the amaryllis flower? A bit of community history for you. How did you know it was the amaryllis if you don't know what it is? I don't know the significance. Do you know the significance of the amaryllis for HD?
Yeah.
I don't know why it was chosen, actually. It's a huge flower. It's the global emblem of the HD community, the kind of global HD movement, the amaryllis. I think the stem represents something and the flowers, the petals represent something else. I don't know why. But anyway, so there's this trial going on called the amaryllis trial. And it's run by a company called Pfizer. Have you heard of Pfizer? Big drug company. Anyone know what other drugs they make? Now I don't want to know what you got for your birthday. There's a drug called Viagra. Have you heard of Viagra? It's a perfectly sensible drug. It's used to treat babies whose lungs haven't developed properly. And it was developed initially as a treatment for high blood pressure. But that's not the main thing it's used for. And I'm not the person to explain what Viagra is to a room full of people much younger than me, but the way it works is important the way it works inside ourselves is important, and I don't have slides of it. It's what's called a PDE10 inhibitor. Viagra is a PDE5 inhibitor. The drug that Pfizer has developed for Huntington's disease is a PDE10 inhibitor. What's a PDE10 inhibitor? Well, this is a brain. And these are our neurons. So these are the electrical signals flying down our neurons. But when one neuron wants to talk to another neuron, there's a problem because there's a gap between them. And instead of sending electricity across the gap, it sends a chemical signal. So you get this electrical signal and then a chemical signal. Anyone know what this gap is called? Synapse.
Or synapse.
Or synapse. People say both. It's like migraine, migraine, potato, potato. Nobody says potato, by the way. It's just not a real word. That's a terrible song. You say potato, I say potato. I'm wrong. I need to learn how to say potato. Right, yeah, so PDE10 inhibitors. So this is what happens in close-up at the second of those neurons, the one that's receiving the signal. A little signaling molecule flies across the membrane, and then basically this cascade of chemical reactions happens, and that generates an electrical signal, and that carries on the message. But then at the end of all of that, you've got all this mess that needs to be tidied up, because this has to happen like 1,000 times a second in all of your brain cells, so they're all very busy. And the things that do the cleaning up are these enzymes. What's an enzyme?
It's something that breaks down the chemical bond to break down the compound.
Some of them do that.
It's a catalyst.
It's a catalyst. What's it made of?
It's a tertiary structure protein.
It's a protein, yeah. A catalyst. You'd think it was like a menu of felines that you could adopt from a shelter. Catalyst. Cat, can I have some water, please? My jokes are going very badly.
Yeah.
Many of them are not even being recognized as jokes, which is a bit much. It's true. So a catalyst is a protein that speeds up chemical reactions. And in this case, what it's going to do is basically break down all of these molecules for recycling so that the whole signaling cascade can begin again. Chomp, chomp, chomp. Have you heard of Pac-Man?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, I'm relieved. So the Pfizer, so what? Essentially something seems to go wrong with these PDE enzymes in HD, and the one that's particularly involved in the bits of the brain that go wrong early in HD is called PDE10. And so Pfizer has made this drug. It has a name. I mean, it doesn't have a name. It's got like a code number that's very, very unsexy, and I can't remember what it is. But we just call it the PDE10 drug. And it's being tested in this trial called Amaryllis. And essentially the idea is that by reducing the activity of those enzymes a little bit, it seems like the signaling across cells, between our brain cells, might be improved slightly. So what we're hoping that it will do is improve movement symptoms and hopefully thinking skills. Because I'm guessing that most of you know someone with HD or have known someone with HD, and the movements are quite famous. That's a career that someone mentioned earlier on. And it used to be called Huntington's career, right? You know that? In fact, a lot of doctors still think it's called that, but it's not. In about the 1960s or 70s, they renamed it Huntington's disease because there's so much more going on. And you guys all know this. One of the biggest problems in HD is the changes in thinking ability. So people's thinking can slow down a bit. People can have trouble doing more than one thing at once. And that's a problem that just tends to get worse and worse as the disease goes on. So we call that cognition or cognitive ability, thinking. And we hope that this drug, this PDE10 drug, will help with thinking and movements. So where are we with it? Well, it started about 18 months ago, early 2015. The trial, I think, that trial is still recruiting, but it's very close to being, no, wait, that's not true. This trial's finished. This trial's fully recruited, yeah. This slide's slightly out of date. A month ago, I was told by Pfizer that the trial is now fully recruited, which is good. So we used to have a problem in HD that we didn't have enough people to go into our clinical trials, and it would take ages to recruit for trials. right now the recruitment seems to be going quite well, but it's still something that slows us down. You know, the trials could always go more quickly if we had more people volunteering. And I think a large part of that is in America, the rate of genetic testing is very low because of how bad the insurance is over there. Question? Right.
Because of the symptoms.
Okay.
So I wasn't in the
Yeah.
group particular.
That's true. And I'm sorry you couldn't be in that trial. I encounter this a lot from my patients who want to be in trials, and we're, you know, even though we're running three trials, there are a lot of people who for one reason or another are not able to be in any of the trials or a particular trial. So all trials have what we call inclusion criteria and exclusion criteria. So the purpose of a clinical trial is to see whether a drug works. And they're very carefully designed to be able to pick up benefits without costing too much. So a clinical trial like this will probably cost about $50 million to run from start to finish, which is a huge amount of money. And that's with these very strict criteria about who can be in the trial. So it might be limited to particular age. Some trials are limited by gender. Some trials will require a very specific disease stage, or you may be not allowed to be in the trial if you're on certain medications that might interfere with the drug, and so on and so on. And it can be very frustrating if you're volunteering for trials and being told that you're not suitable for this trial. What I would say is keep trying, because another trial will come along and you may be suitable for that one. Try and stay enthusiastic, because we do need all of the trial volunteers we can get. And probably for every trial, only one person in 10 will be suitable. But that, you know, so you just have to keep volunteering basically until you find a trial that's suitable for you. And that's why we need as many volunteers as possible. So if we want to recruit 100 people into a trial, we might need 1,000 or 5,000 people to come forward in order to find the 100 who will actually be able to get into this trial and carry it through. And it's quite hard work being in a trial. So this trial takes 6 months and you have to go to hospital 10 times for various assessments. And the people who are in this trial, if they've got on well with the drug, have ended up being in what's called an open label extension, where everyone gets to take the drug at the highest dose that was safe. And so that extension is now going on. So that this trial's not recruiting anymore, it's actually full, and we're waiting for it to finish and waiting for the results. But if it works, it'll be really cool. And it would be the first drug that actually works for those, especially if it works for thinking ability, because right now we don't have any drugs that work. Have you heard of pradopidine? It used to be called ACR16, and it also goes by the name of Huntexil. No, okay. So, have you heard?
There are some Swedish people here. Yeah. Yeah, they mentioned
some of the
Okay.
So, what's really important here is this company, Teva Pharmaceuticals. Hands up if you've heard of Teva. I hadn't really heard of them. And there's also a brand of shoe called Teva. It's not that. As far as we know, there's no shoe that helps Huntington's disease. So Teva's a huge pharmaceutical company, a drug company based in Israel. And about 4 years ago, a guy called Michael Hayden moved from Vancouver to Israel to become the chief scientific officer of Teva. Have you heard of Michael Hayden? Some people have. So Michael Hayden is one of the most famous HD researchers in the world. And basically, Teva wanted to slightly change direction, so they recruited Michael Hayden. And Michael now has taken this multi-billion dollar drug company and is running two clinical trials in Huntington's disease. And no drug company's ever done that before. So one of them is this drug called... Actually, they're now running three trials because they just bought another drug. So they're now running a trial of a drug called pradopidine, which is hopefully going to work for improving voluntary movement, so improving people's movement control in HD, and that's the PRIDE HD trial. That one is fully recruited. That's out of date. Sorry, I didn't update the slide. And the other one is a trial called Legato, which is another Teva trial, and that's testing a drug called lecanemab. And lecanemab basically acts on these cells called microglia. So the brain has an immune system. The immune system in the body fights infection. In the brain, the microglia are the immune system, and they're there to fight off infections and also to kind of clean up any garbage that's lying around. But in HD, they're a bit overactive. So it looks like they get a bit like over-enthusiastic, and they're kind of like riot cops bashing people on the head who probably don't need it. And we think that that probably does more harm than good. So with lecanemab, what we hope is that the activity of the microglia will be gently reduced and the neurons will be able to last longer. That one is not yet fully recruited, but is close to being fully recruited. So that's a trial that's been happening now for about 18 months. So those are three examples of trials that really are targeting very specific features of the known brain problems in HD. And really there's been this huge like swell of new drugs that have come from a really kind of concerted effort worldwide to study the disease. So one thing that's important to know is why this has happened. Like, why are we suddenly getting all these trials now? Where has that like come from? Is it just that things have just been going on normally? Actually, there's been a big surge in HD research in the past 10 years. And it comes from this organization called the CHDI Foundation. Have you heard of that? Hands up if you have not heard of CHDI. So most of you heard of it. What do you know about it?
Provide research funding.
So they provide research funding. What kind of organization is it though? Non-profit. It's a strange organization, to be truthful. So CHDI, it used to stand for Cure Huntington's Disease Initiative, but it just stands for CHDI now. But basically, it's a drug company. I've got a logo somewhere. Let me pull up the CHDI logo. Here it is. There, CHDI Foundation. So it's a drug company, a bit like Pfizer or Teva, but those are run for profit and they make huge amounts of profit. CHDI is a non-profit drug company. So it's a drug company that's also a charity, which is a very strange idea. But it's not the kind of charity that you can donate money to. So if you said to CHDI, I've got $100, 100 euros, or £1,000, or $1 million, they'd say, that's good, but we don't want it. We have enough money. That's weird. So let's have another guess the number game. How much do you think CHDI spent in the past 12 months on HD research? 100 million at the front? Do we think it's more than that or less than that? It is, in fact, more than that. How much? 200 and... Did you say 200?
250.
A bit less than that. 200 million. 200 million US dollars per year on HD research. That is significantly more than the British government spends on lung cancer. And HD is much, much rarer than lung cancer. So this is a huge amount of money. It comes from anonymous donors. So people who are rich and for some reason want to give hundreds of millions of dollars for HD research and only for HD. They're not interested in Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, or any other brain disease. And they're giving this, they've got so much money that 200 million is basically what they cream off the top of their money every year to put into HD research. We don't know who they are, and we don't know why they're giving their money. And we know it's, like, kosher. They're not, like, selling nuclear weapons or anything. It is well known that the money is, legitimate. It's not the proceeds of crime or anything. And I think that's all we need to know. Like, you can wake up in the morning and say, since I went to bed last night, another like $800,000 has been spent on HD research by CHDI Foundation. But they're not just like giving the money away and that's it. CHDI basically is a drug company, so it's kind of a scientific organization that has lots of money. So it works with people like me. I'm an academic researcher. I work for a university and I work for a hospital, and they fund some of my research. But they also do some of their own research, and they will sort of hire out commercial laboratories where they carry out, you know, carefully conducted science work. So CHDI has really transformed the world of HD research. And I have to say, it's probably significantly thanks to CHDI that we're able to be running all of these drug trials now. So CHDI supported Pfizer in some of the early work that led to Pfizer being able to run their PDE trial. CHDI was involved in setting up the pridopidine work, has been involved in studying that drug. CHDI has also been supporting Teva in all of their drug trials. They do this thing that's quite clever. They call it venture philanthropy. So have you heard of venture capitalism, which is basically super rich people investing in something and then hoping that it will give them money? So they like invest in a startup company, and then 5 years later it goes big and they get the money back. That's venture capitalism. Venture philanthropy is basically super rich people supporting charitable projects, but supporting them in a way that comes from like thinking about the financial world. So basically CHDI will invest in the early development of a drug and then will sell that drug to a drug company and get some of their money back. And that's what they did with this next thing I'm going to talk about, which is the thing that Annie mentioned at the beginning, which is gene silencing. So the gene silencing work was a lot of it was supported by CHDI, and then it went very well, and CHDI sold the drug and got its money back, and now that money can be used for something else. So hands up if you've heard of gene silencing. Good. You've all heard of it now, so really, I mean, it's right there on screen. So you should really have all put your hands up. Gene silencing is kind of the simplest possible idea. As soon as you know that you have a gene that causes a disease and it's a harmful gene, the instinct is to say, well, why don't we switch the gene off? And I think the answer is it's really difficult to do. You'll remember that the whole problem starts with DNA, and you'll remember I talked about this idea of DNA as like a recipe book. So the book is kind of locked away in the nucleus, and actually our cells work really hard to prevent the genome being edited. So the idea of editing our genes is something that's being considered, but is very difficult to do because every time you do it, the cell kind of tries to correct the error. So targeting the DNA is difficult. The messenger molecule, though, in the middle, remember that one? DNA, message, protein. The messenger molecule turns out to be slightly easier to target. So we're going to fast forward to basically the most interesting and most exciting thing that's happening right now, which is the thing that Annie mentioned at the beginning, which is the gene silencing Huntington lowering trial, or the ASO trial. This is stuff you definitely need to know about, because actually this could, if this goes well, everyone in this room might need to take this drug soon. Not everyone in this room. Let me issue a correction. Some people in this room might need to start taking this drug quite soon, like sooner than you would think. Because if this drug works, it could be a drug where in a few years, like maybe less than 10 years, we're recommending it to people who have the mutation but no signs of HD as a means of preventing Huntington's disease. So that would be quite cool. But so you need to know about this stuff. So have you heard of ISIS? Exactly. Most people have heard of ISIS. There's a river in Oxford that's called Isis, and there was an Egyptian goddess, the goddess of healing, was where the name Isis originally came from. So there's this drug company called Isis Pharmaceuticals, and their emblem was this pyramid with some DNA on it, and they're based in California. They recently changed their name, for obvious reasons, to Ionis Pharmaceuticals, and they've still got this pyramid, but it's slightly more stylized. Ionis, They're not called ISIS anymore, that's the main thing. So they don't like the phrase, I like the phrase gene silencing because I think it's much easier for people to understand. They prefer to call it Huntington lowering because they feel like silencing a gene is means switching it off completely, and that's not what we're going to do. So this is what the drug kind of looks like. So this is a double-stranded DNA helix, and if you take away one of the strands, you end up with a single strand. And that's basically what this drug is. So they call it Ionis HTTRX. HTT, you will remember, is the abbreviation for the Huntington gene or protein. RX is an old-fashioned way of abbreviating the word treatment. I don't know why, but it is. It's what doctors write when they say treatment, they write RX. So HTTRX is the name of the drug. You can also call it Ionis 443139 if you want to. That's the code name. And it's made of what's called an antisense oligonucleotide, or ASO. ASO is the one I would remember if I were you. HTTRX is an ASO. So the ASO is the kind of family of drugs it belongs to. An ASO is a single strand of chemically altered DNA. Does that make sense? So basically you take a piece of DNA that's two strands, you rip them in half, and then you chemically modify it so that it's slightly different from normal DNA. That's actually kind of not how it's made. It's made a bit more like Lego. So basically the whole thing is synthesized in a machine from scratch. And you will probably be aware that DNA is made of stuff that we abbreviate as letters, right? A, C, G, T. Does that ring bells? Kind of, most of you are nodding. So basically the DNA can be represented as a sequence of letters. And the idea with, the DNA sequence is very well known for Huntington. And in fact, the sequence for every gene is now known. The way that DNA reproduces is that A always sticks to T and C always sticks to G. So in the double helix, if you've got an A on one strand, you'll have a T on the other strand, and they always stick to each other like that. So the DNA is basically not designed, but it's kind of made so that it will always form those pairings. And when those pairs stick together, they always do it in that very predictable way. What that means is that if you think about the... Let me bring up the next slide. If you think about the basic dogma of biology, you know the sequence of the gene that you want to silence, and that sequence is different from every other gene. The message molecule here is similar to one of these DNA strands, and that means that this sequence of letters will be very clearly known. Scientists know what that sequence is. So if you want to design a sort of artificial single-stranded DNA that sticks to that, it's actually very easy to do. If there's an A here, you put a T on your drug strand. If there's a C here, you put a G on there. So it's relatively easy to design a DNA-based drug that will stick to this and won't stick to any other message molecule from any other protein. So that's what they do. They make this drug. So this drug here, this single strand of chemically altered DNA, is designed to stick to a particular sequence within the message molecule from the Huntington gene. And when it does, it activates ancient mechanisms inside the cell, which are there to delete mRNA message molecules. So our cells are constantly making new message molecules, and then the protein's made, and then the cell says, right, I have enough protein now, get rid of the message molecule, and then that switches off the protein manufacture pipeline, production line. So our cells are basically constantly breaking down this stuff. And one of the ways that is done is that the cell makes these single-stranded molecules that stick to it and basically say to the cell, this message molecule is done now, you have to get rid of it. So there are basically very well-established mechanisms inside our cells for doing that. So what this drug is basically doing is hijacking our cell's RNA message deletion system and telling it to get rid of this Huntington message. That's the bad one. We want to get rid of it. Doink. And when you do that, much less of the protein is made. And the hope is that by doing that, the cells can then start to cope with the damage that's already been done. So the idea is that that will prevent future damage, so that harmful protein isn't being made as much anymore. So we may go from, say, 100% to 50% of that harmful protein, and that will make the ongoing process of damage much less severe. But we also hope, remember the mouse where we switched off the gene and it got better? We also hope that something similar will happen if we do this. If we can reduce the production of the mutant protein, we hope that the cell's natural ability to cope with damage will be activated, and suddenly, because they're in full recovery mode, they will hopefully be able to actually improve. We don't know whether that happens yet, but that's what we hope for. So there's a downside to this kind of drug. So these ASO drugs are super cool. Actually, let me tell you something before I talk about this. What's the date today? The 13th of August?
Yeah. Okay.
So something huge happened on the 2nd of August, and it's not to do with Huntington's disease, before I get you too excited. But there's a disease called spinal muscular atrophy, or SMA. Annie's nodding. You follow the news, right? Hands up if you've heard of SMA. Oh, wow. So SMA is a horrible disease that affects children and babies. And basically, SMA babies are born floppy. Their muscles don't work properly. And the muscles are not working properly because their nerves are not working properly. And it comes from the brain and the spinal cord. And within a year or two or three or four, these babies unfortunately die. They lose the ability to, most of them never walk. They stop breathing, and it's a devastating condition. So Ionis Pharmaceuticals, formerly Isis, has been working on an ASO drug that targets the gene that goes wrong in SMA. So a bit like Huntington's disease, SMA type 1 is caused by one gene, so we know the cause of it. And because it's such a devastating disease, Ionis got permission to test the drug really quickly in these kids. I think they've run something like 3 drug trials now. And on the 2nd of August, there was a press release from Ionis and the big drug company Biogen that they've been partnering with for the trial, announcing that the phase 3 trial, so the big sort of trial that they were hoping would get the drug licensed, that trial had to be stopped early because the drug was much more effective than they had expected. So a lot of drug trials get stopped early because they halfway through, they'll do an analysis of all the data so far and say, is this drug working or is it doing really badly? Is it doing much better than we expected, or is it doing as we would expect, or is it worse than we would expect? And a lot of drug trials get stopped because the drug's doing really badly, or it's like they've had too many side effects, or it's just not showing any tendency to give the result that we're hoping for. Most drug trials, you do that analysis halfway through, and the message is, things are on track, we need to finish the trial. I've never heard of a trial before where the trial had to be stopped because the drug was unexpectedly good. That's really amazing news. And as a result of that, that trial was stopped early, and all the kids in that trial, because some of them were taking a placebo, were on a placebo drug. In other words, they were getting injections of a drug which is not a drug, it was just a sort of empty injection. And that's so that you can compare properly with drug versus placebo to figure out what the drug is actually doing. Once you've done this analysis that the drug is actually working, it's unethical to give people a placebo injection. So you have to give everyone the drug. And so all those kids are now on the drug. And what's happening to those kids is that they are sitting up where they wouldn't have been able to previously. And some of the kids are walking, where kids with SMA basically never did that. And there's this press release. If you look at my Twitter feed, I retweeted it a couple of days ago. There's this press release from the company, Ionis and Biogen, that was turned into an announcement by the Cure SMA Foundation, where they basically said, so this drug works for our disease, for our untreatable disease, and now we have to try and get the drug licensed, and soon this drug will be available to all SMA families, and we need to work together to make this happen. And I read that, and I was, it was very difficult for me to, I'm very manly, and very, who's laughing? I'm not an overly emotional person, but it was very difficult to stay it was a very moving thing to read, because I was imagining what it will feel like when we get to read that for Huntington's disease. I believe that that day will come, and it just made me so excited, the idea that we'd be reading an announcement like that about a trial in Huntington's disease that was stopped early because the drug was so effective that everyone has to have this drug as soon as possible. Now, I don't know whether that will happen, but that drug is an ASO drug. It's made by the same company as the drug that's being tested in Huntington's disease, Ionis, and it has the same basic chemical structure, and it's given the same way. So, and you know, once again, we know that the gene we're treating is the gene that causes Huntington's disease. So really, in this trial, everything is up for grabs. As long as nothing goes wrong, I think that it will work. But it might not, and I'm sorry if it doesn't. But I think it will. So the downside to this drug, this HTTRX drug, and all of these gene silencing drugs, is that the brain is a difficult place to get drugs to. So if you package these drugs up in a pill and swallow it, the stomach acid will just dissolve the drug and it won't go anywhere. So if you inject it into the bloodstream, it will fly around the bloodstream for a bit and then it will end up in the liver, which is here on the right. And then it will get broken down and absorbed and won't go anywhere. So to get the drug into the brain is very difficult. And what we figured out though is that if you inject the drug into the spinal fluid, at the base of the spine, and that's called a lumbar puncture. You stick a little needle in, attach a syringe. Don't make that face, it's fine. Squirt the drug in, takes about a minute. The drug spreads up the spinal cord and into the brain. And the work that was done before the trial started suggests that we can probably, with a dose that's safe, we can probably reduce the Huntington level in the brain, the top part of the brain, the cortex, the crinkly bit, by about 50%, and the deeper structures, like the striatum, by about 20%. And we think that's enough to make a very significant difference to Huntington's disease brains. Because, as you will remember, most brains are okay for several decades, even with the mutation causing the protein to be produced. For all those years, the brain is coping really well. And even after people get sick, there are lots of brain cells that are alive and doing a great job of staying relatively healthy. So if we can reduce the level of the mutant protein by 50%, I'd say that that would make a big difference in terms of either helping brain cells to recover, preventing progression of the disease, or indeed delaying onset. So why is it taking so long, I guess, is a reasonable question. It's been, this drug, Ionis HTTRX, has been under development for a decade. And you'll remember this. This is Mickey Mouse, you've heard of him, right? But I showed you earlier what happens when you have this like switch built into the gene. If you don't have that switch, you have a mouse that has the HD gene, the mouse gets sick. If you then give them this drug, HTTRX, the mice get better. And that's good. That's what we were hoping for. And if you give them to mice before they get symptoms, they remain healthy for much longer. So if you give this drug into the spinal column of a monkey, I haven't done it myself, but it's been done, the drug hangs around for about 3 to 4 weeks, about a month, which is long, because like most drugs that you take as a pill, you have to take them every day. But because it's sitting in the nervous system, this drug hangs around for a lot longer. But weirdly, the amount of protein stays reduced for much longer, like 4 months. And that's, I think, evidence that the brain is good at getting rid of this protein, and it takes a while for it to build up again if you only lower it for a bit. So as I say, we're trying to reduce the level by about 50%. This is what the trial looks like. This trial's underway, by the way. It's nearly a year since we started this trial. September the 5th, 2015, was when the first injections of this drug were given. One of them was given by me in London, using this thumb. So it's called a phase 1/2A trial, which means it's basically testing safety.
Safety.
So the main purpose of this trial is to make sure that this drug doesn't kill people. And so far, it hasn't killed anyone. It's being tested in 36 people. That may be expanded to 48 if necessary. And they're all people with very early symptoms of Huntington's disease. So they're within a couple of years of first experiencing motor signs. The minimum age for being in this trial is 25. And that's because we need to test the drug in people whose nervous systems are completely mature and developed. And your brain is still developing until you're about 25. Sorry? Where in the world? So, three sites in the UK. Cambridge, London, Manchester. One in Canada, which is Vancouver. And two in Germany, which is Ulm and Bochum. Don't laugh, that's how you pronounce it. So, I can't say for sure about any particular site, but because it's such a tiny trial, the sites are basically restricting it to six people that they already know really well. And that's kind of just, it's a bit random. Like, the Americans are really frustrated. This trial's not happening in America. And the Americans are like, we want the drug, we want the drug. Everyone has the same view. I guess the thing to return to is this is a safety trial. So we've got no expectation that this drug will help any of the people in the trial. It's basically a short trial designed to prove that the drug can go into a much bigger trial. And the next trial will be the phase 3 trial, where we try and get the drug, we'll prove that the drug works and get it licensed. In this trial, what we're looking at is it safe? And does it cause the kind of changes, chemical changes in the spinal fluid that we think would be good? But there will be another, if this works, there will be another trial. And it won't be very long before we know. So what happens is, three out of every four people gets the drug, and one person gets the placebo injection. So that's just an empty syringe containing salt water, basically. So that you go into this trial, there's a 1 in 4 chance you'll get lots of injections into your spinal fluid of something that's not a drug at all. And that's really important because actually we do need to know how much of any, like if someone gets a really bad headache or something, we need to know whether it's a drug or whether it was the injection that caused that. So having that placebo arm is important. So people are getting 4 injections, baseline 1, 2, and 3 months. So 4 injections, and then they get an extra lumbar puncture for good measure at the end. So that each person is in that trial for about 8 months. And like I say, we started a year ago. It's called an ascending dose design. So basically, a year ago, we started giving tiny, tiny doses. And then in January, we were allowed to go up to the second dose level. And then in June, at the HDSA meeting in Baltimore, I was allowed to announce that we were just about to start the third dose level, and the next one, hopefully, would be scheduled to start in September. And that's the one that we think will be the highest dose level, cohort D, that we'll be able to give. So we're currently dosing in cohort C, and it's going well. I don't know how many people exactly have been dosed, but lots have been dosed now, and there have been no major concerns about safety at all. What we don't have is any idea whether this drug works. No idea at all. People tell us things, but those people could easily be on the placebo injection. We just don't know. This is what it looks like when you give the injections. This is Blair Levitt, who's a neurologist in Canada. This is his thumb. I guess he's left-handed. And this is the needle in the spine of the HD patient. My photo's a bit more, a bit less grim. So this is me giving that injection, and the spine is somewhere down here. You can just see the love handle of the person here. She said it was fine for me to call it that. So that trial's happening, and if that happens, if it all completes successfully, about a year from now, we'll be announcing the results of that trial. And if the result is this drug was safe, and it appeared to work, it appeared to lower Huntington in the CSF, then very rapidly we're going to move on to a much bigger trial. That next trial will probably also be in early HD. So that will be a much bigger trial, probably involving many more centers in lots and lots of different countries. And that will be a trial to basically, probably about 1 year long, to figure out whether the drug actually slows the progression of HD or indeed produces any clinical improvement. So, and after that, the drug will be licensed. So we'll go to the regulatory agencies in Europe and America and say, can we give this drug to all HD patients now? And then that's, can I say shit? That's when the shit will hit the fan. for those of you who are not native English speakers, do you understand that phrase?
Yeah.
Das ist von der Scheiße sagt guten Tag zum Windmill. House Windmill. I'm fluent in German. If you don't understand that, that is not my fault. What it means is that that's when we have a real challenge, because then in London, we have no more than two people at once enrolled in this clinical trial, because it's a lot of work to give these injections. There are about 650 patients that we see in our HD clinic, and if they need all to be given the drug once a month for the rest of their lives, then that will be challenging. However, there are various ways we can get around this. So just thinking out loud, it may be that, I'm going to get rid of this photo because it's weird. It may be that the drug lasts longer than we think. So if the drug sticks around in humans longer than it did in monkeys, we might be able to give these injections every 2 months or 3 months, and that would be much easier. The other thing is, it doesn't necessarily have to be injections every single time. So if we know for sure that the drug works, what we could do is a minor procedure to insert a little pipe, a little thin tube into the spinal fluid, and then it would just sort of sit there, not doing anything, and you wouldn't know it was there. Kind of like how we insert pacemakers into people. It's just a little bit of extra kit that lives inside you. Nothing to worry about. And then, so it would either be connected to a pump, or more likely there would just be a little plastic blob under the skin, and we could just inject the drug into that. And then it would just be an injection into the skin once every month or once every 3 months, rather than having to be given through lumbar puncture. However, what I'd tell you is, if it's a lumbar puncture, that's better than the alternative, right? So if it has to be lumbar punctures, I think that would be better than not having a drug at all. Lumbar puncture's not too scary. I've had three of them, and they were all fine. And it's a thing that gets a lot of bad press. So a lot of people will associate lumbar puncture with things like emergencies where you're taken to hospital in the middle of the night, and there's people are worried you've got meningitis, and you have to have a lumbar puncture to check you haven't got meningitis or that you haven't had a brain hemorrhage. And so it's quite a scary sounding thing. When we do them in clinical trials or in neurology, it tends to be a very sort of relaxed process. It's all very quick and straightforward. We do hundreds and hundreds of them. Actually, doing lumbar punctures is a big focus of my research. And in fact, I don't know if any of you have heard of a man called Charles Sabine. So Charles, earlier in the month, actually it was mid-July, about a month ago now, Charles came and had a lumbar puncture as part of my research. He's not in the drug trial, he was just having giving a sample so we can study the spinal fluid. And this is Charles holding his spinal fluid. It's difficult to see, but it's about 15 milliliters. It looks a bit like gin or water. gin, obviously, is preferable. And I did the lumbar puncture, and he was still smiling. He was a bit of a baby about it, but don't tell him I said that. So there we are. I guess that's where we're up to in terms of the research. When I started in HD in 2005, I was very young, and I just heard about that first experiment where the first gene silencing drug was given to a mouse, and the mouse got better. And I went back to the clinic, my first proper HD clinic, and the patients would always say, "What's happening with the research? What's happening with the research?" I said, "Well, we don't have any trials at the moment, but I've just heard about this thing called gene silencing, and you know, the idea is to switch off the gene, and it prevents all the problems in HD." And they would always say, "Well, that sounds brilliant. Sign me up. How long will it be before we can do a trial of it?" And I would say, "Well, it's very early days. It'll be about 5 to 10 years before the first trials in humans." And it was exactly 9 years and 11 months between me starting in that first clinic on the 5th of October 2005 and me giving the first injection on the 5th of September 2015. So it takes a while, and I'm really sorry it takes such a long time. I feel it very personally whenever I read about or whenever I hear about someone who's died or someone who's become unwell, because every single day is precious, and every day where we could have done something and it didn't happen is hugely frustrating to me. But like I say, this stuff happens because we all work together as a global HD community, and patients and researchers are the same, part of the same team. We all need to work together. So what can you do? I hope you're wondering what you can do to make this stuff happen more quickly, because it could be 2025 before the first drug actually works, or before we have a pill that you can take that will cure Huntington's disease. But if there's a chance that could be 1 year earlier, if there's anything anyone can do, I would say do that. Because you want to read that press release that says, "This trial was halted unexpectedly early because the drug worked." So let's make that happen as soon as possible. I think the answer is volunteer to take part in research. So a lot of research is not open to younger people. So a lot of... for most research, you need to be 18 or over. For drug trials, it's usually 21. The gene silencing trials, because it's changing Huntington protein and it's kind of monkeying around in your brain box, is 25. So age is an issue. But there are certainly studies that any 18-year-old can take part in. The one that I would focus on is called Enroll HD. Which has been mentioned already, and I guess most of you have heard of Enroll HD. Enroll HD is a worldwide study of HD. It's aiming to be the biggest ever study of Huntington's disease. If you're from an HD family, you can take part in Enroll HD. What's involved is you sign a consent form, and then you answer some questions about your health, some questions about your family, some questions about what medications you might be taking. There's a blood test, so you have to give a blood sample, which is, you know, not exactly fun, but it's not the end of the world. And then they'll get you to do some, like, tests. So there's some thinking tests, which are quite good fun, like matching colours to words, saying how many words you can think of in 1 minute, beginning with the letter F or S or A, and, you know, there are other letters as well. So some thinking tests. There's no brain scans in Enroll HD, but there are lots of other projects which do involve brain scans. And why do we do this? I mean, what's the point? Well, don't we know enough about HD already? Actually, no, we don't. One of the big things we don't know about HD is what are the things that people are already doing in their everyday lives that change the course of Huntington's disease? Like, for instance, if eating chocolate was good for Huntington's disease brains, how would we know that? What we would need to do is study a huge population of people, look at the ones who eat chocolate, look at the ones that don't, and figure out whether the course of their HD changed over the period where they were studied. And that requires a huge number of people, and they need to be studied regularly, basically throughout their lives. So this is the stuff that, you know, it's not a drug trial, but what it's doing is it's really helping us to understand HD and to understand about the stuff that we can't study in any other way. So that's one thing. The main other thing that Enroll HD is what's called a platform. So it's basically like the national football team of your country will have a team of 11 people who are the top 11 who go onto the pitch. I'm going to get out of my depth here talking about football, but anyway. So there's 11 people, players, I think they're called, who go on, and that's the team. And then there's a load of other people, right? And that's called the squad, right? Help me out here, Matt. Is that right? Squad, that's the thing, right? How many people in the England squad? Roughly? 100? No one knows. No one in the room knows anything about football. Okay. So, it's about 100. So, but what Enroll HD is basically a chance to be in the squad from which the team is picked when it comes to running clinical trials. Oh. So, like I say, each trial may be slightly difficult to get into because small numbers and very strict inclusion criteria mean that lots of people who are interested in a trial may not be eligible for it. So the idea is instead of getting the trial and saying, now who have we got that's suitable? You assemble the squad in advance. You come up with this big list of people. It's like a catalyst, but it's made of people instead of cats. Who can take part in Enroll HD? Anyone from an HD family. So if you have HD, you can take part. If you are at risk from HD but haven't been tested, you can take part. A genetic test is done, but no one involved in your care will ever know the results. So it's done in a laboratory in Italy, and it's done on a sample that's coded. It's used as a code number. It's not linked to your name at all. So there's no way that that test result could ever get back to you or to your HD team. You look terrified. Or are you cold?
No.
Okay. That's your listening
She's
face,
fine.
Is it? She's doing this?
She's fine.
Okay.
Ignore her.
Okay. So, people who are at risk and haven't been tested can take part in Enroll HD. People who have had a positive test result but don't have symptoms can take part in Enroll HD. People who've had a negative test result and don't have symptoms can also take part in Enroll HD. Partners and other family members can take part. So, anyone. And you get your travel expenses paid, so it won't cost you anything. You might have to take a day off work. And I have to say, it's an incredibly valuable and important project for the whole HD community because it's really setting up now what we will need in terms of numbers of people for the next generation of clinical trials. So the next big gene silencing trial will be selected from the Enroll HD database. So if you want to be in the next big gene silencing trial in 2 or 3 years or 5 years, if I were you, I would sign up for Enroll HD now. Because it's a good way of, it's like you're joining the queue outside the nightclub. You're not in the club, but at least you're in the running.
Just to mention for the Norwegians, we are still not in the enroll. It's a delay. But we are in registry still.
Mm.
But that's the same. So
yeah.
You can go get in the registry and we will transmit into enroll.
Yes, so that's important. The registry study is the was a sort of front runner to Enroll. So registry was a European study. Enroll is a study that's running globally.
Is it the same in Sweden that we have registry still? Because I don't think there are any clinics in Sweden doing Enroll.
Sweden, I'm pretty sure Sweden was in registry. So if it's not yet gone into Enroll, then do sign up for registry, because in terms of the data that's collected is very similar, and it has the same function as a trial recruitment platform. So, yeah.
It can depend on the site, because Matthias says he's in Enroll.
Mm-hmm.
It's my doctor it is going on
now. Okay, that's cool. So there are more and more sites and countries being added. It takes a while, but they're coming on board the whole time. Even if registry or enroll is not running at your local HD research center or clinic, you can that most clinics run some kind of research program, so that as well as Enroll HD, we have our own local research database, which is basically just a list of the names of people who've said they're interested in research, and they're happy to be phoned up if there's a research project going or a trial that they might be suitable for. So, and I think the other thing that a lot of people don't necessarily realise is you don't have to have symptoms of HD to be able to be seen in an HD clinic. So I'm guessing you guys know about genetic counselling and how that works and how you get referred for a genetic counselling appointment. So you see your GP and the GP will get you an appointment with a genetic counsellor. But that sort of tends to happen in isolation. So a lot of those genetic counselling appointments and the whole testing process tends to be separate from the clinics where patients are looked after. And in the middle, there's a lot of people who may have had a genetic test that was positive, but they don't have symptoms of HD. And I think a lot of those people sort of feel like there's nothing happening for them or that they're completely ignored. But actually, in our clinic and in every other clinic I know of, they're always happy to see people in the clinic who don't have HD, but they're from a family or they may have had a positive test result. And one of the things that I will often do is spend an hour or 45 minutes just talking to someone from an HD family about what's happened in research and what they might want to take part in. So, you know, it's not something to be scared of. Like, the HD clinics can sometimes be slightly scary places because obviously there are people there who have HD, and if you're someone who just kind of wants to not think about that stuff too much, which is, I think, understandable, and just kind of get on with life, then that's fine. No one's saying you have to go to an HD clinic. But I'm saying if you feel it might be helpful to talk to someone about research in particular, getting an appointment in the HD clinic can be quite a useful way of doing that. And no one's ever going to force you into doing any research you don't want to do. HD Clarity is worth mentioning. So this is a new trial that I'm setting up, which is a study of spinal fluid. It's looking at lumbar punctures to extract spinal fluid, to study that and understand Huntington's disease. And this is going to be the first ever global, multinational spinal fluid study of HD. What's important about that is that if you've had a lumbar puncture done for research, that makes it much easier to sign you up for a clinical trial involving lumbar punctures. Because if we know that it was easy to do a lumbar puncture, then you're more likely to be towards the top of the list when it comes to trials that involve lumbar punctures. So that's worth thinking about. But there are always, most study centres, most clinics will have some kind of research program where you can go along and you can sign up for things like brain scans or thinking tests or exercise trials or all sorts of things. My advice would basically be sign up for everything you're eligible for. Whatever you have time for, help with. If you want to be in a trial but they tell you that you're too young or you're not suitable for whatever reason, my other piece of advice is be a wingman. So you may have a family member who, this is from Top Gun, you've probably never heard of that film, have you? That's Maverick and that's Goose. And they have a homoerotically charged relationship. Involving, they're so not just friends, okay. You need to watch that film again. Anyway, Goose is Maverick's wingman, and they look after each other in a very special way. And they...
You need to watch that film again.
Oh, believe me, I've watched it many times. Anyway, so what you need to know is that if you are not suitable for a trial, you may have a family member who is. And like I say, being in a trial is quite hard work, quite a lot of visits to the hospital. A lot of trials need someone to sort of help with the visits, help with transport, help organize, help remind people to take the drugs and so on. So think about other people in your family or in your network that may be able, that may be suitable. Tell them about trials that are happening. And the other thing is, you know, as I'm sure you all are, be super active on social media. So whenever you read something good on HD Buzz or any other website, tweet about it, put it on Facebook, get people talking about research. Because the more that, I think, you know, the people who come to this room are already like miles ahead of most of the HD community. You know, you guys are the people who've decided this is something I need to think about. I want to meet other people in a similar situation. I want to face it head on and do whatever I can. I want to talk to people. I want to be active. there's hundreds of other young people throughout the world who aren't like that, not yet, and who are still kind of living alone, living in fear, living unnecessarily detached from great sources of support like HDYO and like you guys. So try and reach out, bring them into the community, let them know that this stuff's happening. Let them know that 1 year ago, the first ever gene silencing trial in Huntington's disease began, and it's now on its third dosing level, and so far there have been no major issues with the trial. And if that trial goes well, then a year from now, the pivotal trial will be beginning that gets that drug licensed, and that will be the first drug that slows down Huntington's disease. And that's one of 14 trials now happening in Huntington's disease. And the drugs that are being tested are the best drugs we've ever had, targeting specific known problems caused by the Huntington's disease mutation and the protein, which was discovered 23 years ago. And there's a company called CHDI, which is putting $200 million a year into HD research. And every day we know more than we knew the day before about Huntington's disease. And eventually good things will happen. Tell them that. So I want to just talk briefly about this tree, because there's a Chinese, the title of my talk was The Best Time to Plant a Tree. When's the best time to plant a tree?
No.
Kind of, that's a good answer, but that's not the correct answer. It's a Chinese proverb. The best time to plant a tree is 20 years ago. The second best time is today. So if you can't go back in time and plant a tree 23 years ago, those trees that were planted then are growing now, but we need to keep planting new trees because it's going to take a big effort from everyone in the world if we're going to beat Huntington's disease. But I think we can do it. So ask me questions. Oh, give me a round of applause. It's a very unseemly noise from the Scottish lady at the back. Who'd have thought it? I always forget to stop. Question.
I have two. The first one. Why can you take part in the tests or in the trials if you're negative? Is it just for like a comparison, or like what benefit?
You wouldn't be able to, so clinical trials testing drugs wouldn't involve people who are negative because they don't have the damage going on. Yeah, so the one that, it's exactly, so the one is, it's enroll HD, and it's exactly that. Basically, we need people who don't have the HD gene as a kind of control group. Yeah, so we call it a control group, basically to compare like the thinking test, for instance. If you're 25 years old and you get 80 out of 100 on a particular thinking test, and someone else gets 75, is that because of an effect of the gene, or is that just natural variation? So the controls, the gene negative people, give us an idea of the natural variation in the sort of healthy brain population, so that we can figure out what's due to the mutation and what's not.
Okay. Second of all, what made you get into this? Like, why is this such a passion for you?
That's a good question. So, for the microphone, the question was, why did I get into Huntington's disease? Basically, I was a junior neurology doctor looking for something to do research on, because everyone who does neurology has to do some research before they become a consultant. So I was looking for various things, and I worked in this hospital in London called the National Hospital for Neurology and Neurosurgery. So I was surrounded by super smart people, And several of them had projects that they were sort of wondering if I was interested in. And one of them was a person called Sarah Tabrizi, who's now a professor of neurology and the head of the HD research group in London. And she said, well, come, I've got this project that might be interesting for you. And it was a brain scanning project in Huntington's disease. So I thought, oh, well, I like Sarah Tabrizi. She's brilliant. But HD sounds a bit depressing, to be honest. Why don't I come to a clinic and see what it's like? And I'm thinking about other stuff, and I'll just see how it goes. So I went to that clinic, and what I saw was, this was a group of people with really crappy things happening in their lives, you know, symptoms and you know, problems with work, and problems, you know, problems mobilizing, and problems getting the social services to help them, and that kind of stuff. And what I realized was that if this clinic didn't exist, There'd be no one who was interested in that problem. There, what this was, it was just a group of people who happened to have said, you have this problem and we will look after you. We will help you. Huntington's disease is important to us. It's not just something that can be handled by general neurologists or GPs or you know people in the community. This is, we know how bad your problems are and we can't take them away, but we will do what we can. And that was all it took for these HD family members to suddenly be able to overcome a lot of these problems. It was simply having that clinic there in existence, having a bit of help directed towards, and people who understood the nature of their problems, and that help directed towards them. And that was all it took really to help those families to help themselves. And it made a huge difference because HD families are so strong. They're the strongest people I know. And I really, it really, that's my source of inspiration, is the strength that I see in families affected by HD. My friend Jeff Carroll, who co-founded HD Buzz with me, is from an HD family. And Jeff, I met Jeff in 2007, and we launched HD Buzz in 2010. And Jeff has tested positive for the HD mutation. So he's got 42 CAG repeats in his HD gene. So at some point in the next few years, probably, he's gonna start showing symptoms of HD. My Charles Sabine is a good friend of mine, he's got the HD mutation, and it's I'm in part of this community as a result of going to that clinic and signing up for a PhD, and I'm part of the community, and I can't leave that behind. It's just there's no way I could turn my back on that until we fix the problem, and then I can start working on male pattern baldness. So, you know, hurry up, guys. Help me out here. Any other questions?
With the gene silencing, will that mean it's not going to be passed down? Will it still get passed down if it works, or just in that person it will stop?
Yeah, so the question was, will gene silencing work just for the person it's given to, or would it help future generations? So gene silencing wouldn't help future generations. It would only, because the DNA stays the same, and that's what's passed down. The gene silencing only works on the message molecule. Two things, though. There are ways of making sure that you can have kids without passing down HD. So they're, you know, they're assisted fertility options. Less fun than having babies the traditional way, much less fun. But, kids guaranteed free of HD, it's available on the NHS. It's absolutely worth thinking about. And you may not know that you don't have to have a genetic test in order to go through PGD, pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. So PGD can be done if you're at risk from HD, but you don't want to have a test. It can be done on men and women from HD families, and you can do this thing called non-disclosure testing, where basically you can implant embryos that don't have the mutation, even if the dad or mum who's at risk hasn't been tested themselves. And those, that's basically as effective as the normal, as the testing route. It's a bit more complicated because you have to get DNA from other family members in some cases, but that can be done. So that was point one. Point two is gene silencing just sort of turns down the volume control, but there's this thing called gene editing or genome editing. Hands up if you've heard of CRISPR. Yeah, so CRISPR is a new technology that's been, it's an ancient technology that evolved in bacteria millions of years ago. But in the past few years, it's been kind of hijacked for use as a research tool and as a means of editing people's DNA. So ultimately, what we may end up doing is giving people an injection of a virus that infects the brain cells with a machine that is basically like a pair of DNA scissors and looks for the expanded CAG, the mutation that causes HD, snips it out and joins the ends together, and will fix the mutation. And that, theoretically, could pass down, could help fix the next generation as well. Fix is a bad word. Help prevent HD from reaching the next generation. There are many obstacles to that, but that's what we were saying 10 years ago about gene silencing, and we're doing that now, so who knows. More questions?
Just described with Mickey Mouse about getting better.
Mm.
But you said that it's difficult because brain cells can't repair themselves. But also, maybe longer than that years ago, people didn't think neurogenesis happened at all. Now that's been proven.
Yeah, that's true.
Yes, perfectly plausible that we could be able to help even our relatives.
Yeah. It's true, absolutely. I mean, I think that if gene silencing works, I think we will see improvement. So genes, we can't replace neurons at the moment, but they actually can repair themselves. As long as they're hanging on by their fingernails, I think that as soon as you reduce the protein, they will be able to recover. Because actually, if you think about it, they've reached that position with all of their recovery mechanisms fully activated, like the protein removal stuff and the cellular repair stuff is fully activated already in those cells. So the gas pedal is kind of fully depressed, and by reducing the Huntington protein a little bit, you can really like hit the ground running, I think, in these cells just by reducing Huntington a little bit. You're right, though. The brain does make new cells, so theoretically, if we could... It's what's less clear is what those new cells do, because there aren't very many of them, as far as we know. So if you could edit the sort of brain stem cell precursors, you could perhaps produce a new supply of healthy brain cells that don't have the mutation, and that would be easier than changing the DNA in the whole brain. But it's not clear how much of a big difference that would make. One thing we do want to do, though, is cell replacement therapies. And I don't normally talk about that because it's not something that's going to be making a big difference to patients and families soon. But so what you can do now is take a skin sample and turn that into stem cells that you can then turn into neurons. And we've not been able to do that for very long. The recipes for doing that have only recently been developed. You could combine that with the CRISPR gene editing to basically take skin cells from a patient with HD, grow neurons, and then edit those neurons so that they don't have the mutation. And then what you have is healthy neurons that correspond to that patient in everything except that they haven't got the mutation. And then stick them in the brain, help them to grow, and they could replace the cells that have been lost. And provided we want them to do simple things like control of movements or like the straightforward connections between brain regions, it's theoretically possible that could produce significant benefits. There was one person, earlier on there was a trial of fetal stem cells, so taking stem cells from fetuses that had been terminated, using that was going to happen anyway, and rather than, you know, just throw that tissue away, take the neurons from it and try and do some good with them. And basically, those neurons were implanted into the brains of HD patients. I think something like 5 or 7 patients had those transplants. And what emerged really from that work was that we didn't really know where to put the neurons to help them to survive. So the implants didn't last for very long. But there was one guy who had been who'd been too unwell to work. And after his transplant, after his embryonic transplant, he was able to go back to work. And he seemed to stay well for quite a while. But that's just one patient. And the clear conclusion was, we're not in the position to be doing these grafting operations yet. What we really need is a better source of tissue, which would be genetically engineered neurons from stem cells. And then we really need to understand where in the brain to put them and what kind of other stuff to do to them to get them to plumb in and make the proper connections to the surrounding cells. But it's all stuff that's possible. And stuff that's theoretically possible is how we start making things happen, you know, that's a good starting point. More questions?
There are a couple of different mechanisms why the Huntington expansion, the gene causes the damage to the neuron. For example, sort of soluble ones going back into the neuron and sort of protein clumping together to cause it. The neurons to stop working properly. What is the current mechanism that you think? What's the reason for the end?
Yeah. So how does mutant Huntington cause damage? many, many, many different ways, basically. We don't fully understand what the wild type protein does, what the healthy protein does, but it seems to do a lot of things. So what that means is essentially it's interacting with a lot of different structures and functions around the cell. The mutant protein seems to go wrong in a number of ways. So the mutant protein is toxic, has a number of different toxicities. So it seems to interfere with the cell's metabolism, so the way they use energy. It interferes with the DNA transcription control, so the transcriptional regulation, so the switching on and off of different genes. The mutant protein seems to mess around with that, and that's kind of like an elephant just running amok in the control room of a nuclear power station, just hit the switches, loads of things go wrong. There are the aggregation is an interesting one, because we don't know whether that's helpful or harmful. So we see aggregates forming in cells, but it's not clear whether preventing those aggregates from forming is good or bad at the moment. The soluble stuff seems to be the more toxic stuff. And one of the things that happens to the full-length protein is it gets snipped into this fragment called exon 1 fragment, which is much more mobile, and that's the stuff that can get into the nucleus. So I think that the stuff that happens in the nucleus, I think, is important. One of the other things that happens is that mutant Huntington prevents the production and transport of a protein called BDNF, which is brain-derived neurotrophic factor. So this is produced by the cortex, but it helps the striatum to stay alive. And it's dramatically reduced in HD, which gives us a potential target, because if we can restore BDNF levels, then that would be good. And that also gives us reason to believe that this silencing in the cortex will be good for the whole brain, because if we can switch off the mutant protein just in the surface of the brain, which is easier to do, then that will probably have knock-on effects for the regions that are connected via BDNF and by other mechanisms. It's complicated. There's a very good review in Movement Disorders, 2015, by Tabrizi and Wild. I recommend it. You seem like the kind of person who can find and download an academic journal article. It's a very well written article. Go ahead. Yeah. So what can you do differently in your everyday lives that will make a difference to your future? Staying active is the only one that has evidence for it. So there's evidence that people who have an active lifestyle as opposed to a sedentary lifestyle have a better outcome later onset with HD. There's nothing else that's been shown to work. There is stuff that's generally good for brains. So stuff that's good for your heart and your blood vessels is good. So having a healthy diet and, again, exercising, that's good. I don't think there's anything else specific that I can advise. There's certainly no supplements that I would recommend that you take. A lot of people do. Creatine, coenzyme Q, fish oil, blueberries, etc. None of it is known to work. A lot of it's known not to work. So we know fish oil doesn't work. We know creatine doesn't work. We know coenzyme Q doesn't work. Anything else is pretty much guesswork, but keep your brain healthy. Don't smoke, don't drink too much, probably. That's a really crappy thing to say on someone's 18th birthday, but drink a little bit, but not too much. And I have to say, if it were my 18th birthday and I was thinking about keeping my brain healthy when I was 40, I would sign up for Enroll HD, because that's the stuff that lays the foundation for the future trials of the new drugs that, if you need them, will then be there earlier to protect your brain from the problems that HD causes. And all this stuff as well, I have to say, be part of HDYO. This is a treatment for Huntington's disease. Not kidding. Give yourselves a round of applause.